me start by introducing myself. I'm Tina Klein. I'm new at BC this year. I'm in the English department and also involved in American Studies, so it's nice to see some familiar faces and many new faces. We're very excited about the speaker series. We're bringing four distinguished American Studies speakers to campus during this calendar year, and they're going to share their cutting-edge scholarship with us. But they're also going to help us think about the presence and role of American Studies here at BC, what the future for American Studies might look like for BC, and we're hoping they will help us make it a bigger future and a brighter future. So that's part of what the series is all about. The other speakers in the series are going to be Gary Okahiro from Columbia, who's coming on March 31st in cooperation with the sponsors of Asian Pacific American Heritage Month at BC. And then next fall, we'll have Phil Deloria and George Lipsitz. We want to thank Joe Quinn, the Dean of Arts and Sciences, and the Cooney Family Faculty Research Fund for supporting this series and by extension American Studies. We are thrilled to have Melanie McAllister with us today. Melanie is an Associate Professor of American Studies and International Affairs at George Washington University, and she's the author of Epic Encounters, Culture, Media, and U.S. Interests in the Middle East since 1945. Epic Encounters is a fantastic book, as I'm sure quite a few of you probably know. It's widely praised and widely assigned in all kinds of courses. It's really a model. It's a great book for a number of reasons. It's really a model of classic American studies in a lot of ways. She analyzes culture in relation to history and politics in ways that really enable us to see the United States in new ways with fresh perspectives. But it's also a model of the new transnational wing of American studies, thinking about America in the world and thinking about how Americans see the Middle East, how their perceptions of the Middle East are shaped by and in turn shape America's political, economic, and military actions in the world. And finally, I think the book also is important because it also offers a very thoughtful and nuanced revision of Edward Said's notion of Orientalism, and really allows us to see how distinctive the American version of Orientalism really is, and it's not just a kind of pale copy of the European version. So it's an important book for those three reasons, if for no others. In the best tradition of American studies, Melanie has also contributed to public discussions about the Middle East. She's written articles for the New York Times, Washington Post, the Christian Science Monitor. She's also been interviewed on the BBC, NPR, CNN, and she's also worked with American Studies programs in the Middle East, delivering lectures and consulting with them on their programs. So she's very much active as a public intellectual in our favorite phrase. She's currently working on a book about evangelicals, internationalism, and popular culture, which is tentatively titled Our God in the World, and her talk today is drawn from that new work. The title of today's talk is The Global Visions American Evangelicals. Please join me in welcoming Melanie McAllister. And Melanie is also happy to take questions and have discussion after her talk.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that introduction, Tina. It's one of the problems of having such nice introductions is then you have to live up to them, but I will try. And thanks also to the American Studies Program for asking me here. I'm really happy to be here at BC and to get a chance to talk with all of you and to also talk with the faculty in American Studies. That's a real pleasure. As Tina mentioned, my new book, which I'm really just getting started on the work for that book, is called, or I hope it will be called, Our God in the World, The Global Visions of American Evangelicals. Let me start by telling you a story. About 2 years ago, the right-wing evangelical news magazine, The World, honored Reverend Franklin Graham as what they called Daniel of the Year, an honor that recognized those who have the determination and, in their words, courage under fire to proclaim the truth of God to an unbelieving world. Now, Daniel, you may recall, was the wise counselor to the king of Babylon, who was thrown into the lion's den for worshiping God instead of the king, and yet emerged unscathed. Graham, as I'm sure most of you remember, is one of the evangelists who made headlines after September 11th when he called Islam, quote, an evil and wicked religion. the son of Billy Graham. He's also leader of one of the world's best-known missionary organizations, Samaritan's Purse, and I'll talk more about that later today. The world praised Graham for being willing to speak the truth about Christianity and also for his missionary and evangelical work, particularly in Muslim countries like Afghanistan, the Sudan, and the Balkans. Having braved various lions' dens then, Graham told the world that speaking up for Jesus was becoming increasingly difficult. I'm quoting here, "Today, the Church of Jesus Christ is under attack," he said. "There's an onslaught against the church. Being an evangelical Christian is not a popular position anymore, and it's getting worse, not better." Now, that statement might seem surprising coming from Franklin Graham, whose personal friend George W. Bush is in the White House, and who delivered a prayer at the last two presidential inaugurations. He's also one of the conservative evangelicals who are often involved in the weekly White House phone conversation with conservative evangelical Christians over politics and strategy. But Graham's comments do make a certain kind of sense in context, because in recent years, the single hottest international issue among evangelicals is the problem of persecuted Christians. Christians are being martyred all over the world, they argue, prevented from spreading the gospel, and persecuted for their faith. And American Christians, while not facing the same kind of persecution, same kind of literal persecution, also see themselves as under attack, their own sense of embattledness enhanced and in some ways enabled by attention to the situation of evangelical Christians outside the United States. I said American Christians, but I meant American evangelicals, I'm sorry. So their own sense of embattledness enhanced and in some ways enabled by attention to the situation of Christians outside the United States. My talk today focuses on the ways in which visions of Christians as persecuted around the world has become increasingly important in churches, on the web, in evangelical popular culture, and centrally to the political activities of a key group of activists. It's made many evangelicals far more focused on human rights, particularly religious freedom as an issue, as I'll talk about in some detail. But it's also played a role in fomenting an increasingly hostile vision of Islam among a large number of evangelicals, though certainly not all. That anti-Islamic hostility has been linked to foreign policy initiatives that often highlight Christian suffering over that of other religious or secular groups, and I'll come back to talk about that in some detail. But Franklin Graham's global visions don't end with a focus on persecution. One of the things that most clearly differentiates Graham from his famous father is the fact that he made his name through a missions and aid organization, Samaritan's Purse. Graham's organization and others like it, say World Vision, for example, have been deeply involved in providing humanitarian aid to some of the most devastated parts of the globe, arriving early and staying late in Rwanda, Somalia, the Sudan, and many other places. Now, of course, donations to human suffering around the world by Christians is certainly not a new thing, evangelical Christians or otherwise. I grew up as a Southern Baptist in North Carolina, and we always had the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. Somebody's shaking their head, yeah, right? This was Christmas in August, where you gave like tissue paper and pens and stuff, and they would be delivered by Christmas to the poor people in China. And that was, you know, a kind of global vision. And it was a kind of internationalism. But something is different here when you see people like Graham, who sent helicopters into no-fly zones in southern Sudan when the UN wouldn't fly there because it was forbidden by the government. His people also followed behind the U.S. Army in Afghanistan, in Iraq, to, for better or worse, bring hospital supplies. So they're both they're in these war zones in all sorts of complicated ways. So in that sense, evangelical Christians are and have been offering the most basic services of food and medical care in the middle of wars, in the face of violence and opposition, and in places where the UN fears to tread. Graham also got out in front of other conservative Christians on HIV/AIDS. In 2002, he organized a gathering of international Christian leaders, calling on them, especially evangelicals, but not only, calling on them to stop avoiding the issue. The limiting factor in dealing with HIV/AIDS, he said, has been conservative Christian churches. They've attached a stigma to the disease, associating it with homosexuality or sexual promiscuity, and thus have ignored their social responsibility. Quoting him now, "AIDS is the gravest threat to world security, Graham told a reporter. It's not Saddam Hussein. These people have no hope. We need to reach out to them, care for them, whether they are gay, straight, children, or whatever. In 2003, in part as a result of pressure by evangelical groups, Bush called for $15 billion to AIDS relief for Africa. Now, it remains the case that this AIDS program was eventually funded by the Bush administration, is, in the opinion of many observers, including myself, very problematic in many ways. It tends to focus on innocent victims only. It refuses to fund condom distribution, that sort of thing. I'm not arguing here for how perfect the agenda is. Instead, I want to highlight what's new for these religious activists who, led by conservatives like Graham, pushed for and got the administration to commit to spending billions of dollars to put people in Africa and the Caribbean on antiviral drugs. So today I'm going to talk about the link between these two perhaps seemingly contradictory strands in evangelicalism. I want to show how the reality of religious persecution in various parts of the world has been presented within evangelical popular culture in complex and often problematic ways. At the same time, I want to highlight how the focus on Christian persecution has made evangelicals into a powerful force for international economic and social programs. As Richard Holbrooke, Bill Clinton's former ambassador to the UN, recently told an interviewer, the entry of Christian conservatives into American foreign policy as pro-aid people was, in his words, one of the most important new developments in American foreign policy in the last generation. As I hope I'll make clear, I'm deeply disturbed by some of the global visions that have been produced by the anti-persecution movement, but I'm also convinced that there is persecution, as I'll talk about, that is important to think about, but also that the movement has been an impetus for the emergence of a new kind of global social justice consciousness among evangelicals, most of whom one would otherwise label politically and socially as well as theologically conservative. What I'll describe today as the new evangelical internationalism is, I believe, profoundly influencing the nature of evangelical politics and culture today, reframing the meaning of international relations, and in some ways, redefining conservatism for the post-Cold War generation of Protestant evangelical Christians. I know that's a blank slide. I just put it to give us a breather here. Somewhere between 25 and 40% of American adults claim to be born again or evangelical. The exact percentage depends on how you ask the question. One basic definition of evangelicalism that I'm going to be using today, which is put forward by Mark Knoll and others, is that it centers on four beliefs. One is the necessity of conversion or being born again. The second is the Bible as the Word of God, the source of truth. The third is the importance of evangelizing. And finally, fourth, a focus on Jesus' death on the cross as the mediation between God and human beings. That is the path towards God and to heaven. That distinguishes evangelicals from, say, theologically liberal Protestants who might see the Bible as authored by human beings with insights into God or as some inspired by God but not directly, literally the Word of God, or those who might think that it isn't necessary to be born again to go into heaven. Of course, I'm aware of speaking at BC at a Catholic college, and that it's very different than certain kinds of Catholic theology, though there are some Catholic evangelicals who I'm not going to be talking about today, but I'd be happy to have some of you talk about or to try to discuss during the Q&A. It's also important to say that Protestant evangelicals as a group are quite diverse. They're not only white conservatives of the South and Midwest, but also African Americans, most of whom are doctrinally evangelical. So when I say evangelical, I include a large swath of the African-American Christian community. Some Asian-Americans, increasing numbers of Latinos, not to mention some Arabs and some Jews. They're also politically divided, ranging from right-wing, conspiracy-minded, prophecy watchers, to African-American social conservatives who vote Democratic, to the left-leaning pro-life peaceniks at Sojourners. Certainly, different people within evangelicalism disagree and disagree strongly about a broad range of issues. But in all their diversity, evangelical Christians in the United States increasingly understand themselves to be a part of a truly global community of believers. And that's a very important change that I want to talk about. Of course, Christianity has been a global religion for centuries, and the idea of an international network of Christians has been important to American believers since at least the 19th century, when evangelizing the world in this generation, to quote the movement, evangelizing the world in this generation was a broadly shared Protestant ambition. But I'd argue that something has subtly altered, so that many American evangelicals understand themselves to be not only interested in evangelizing the rest of the world, but very much part of, and in some ways subject to, a global body of believers. That is to see people in a much more horizontal fashion. And I don't mean only primarily institutionally, but religiously, theologically, emotionally. In sub-Saharan Africa and Latin America, Christianity, particularly Protestant Christianity, is growing faster than anywhere else on earth. By the year 2050, these two continents together, that is sub-Saharan Africa and Latin America, will account for half of the Christians on the planet. At that point, only about one-fifth of the world's Christians will be non-Hispanic white Americans or Europeans. It's already the case that as many as 70% of the world's Protestant evangelicals live in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. And nobody's more aware of the changing face of global Christianity than American evangelicals, who in churches or via email or in other fashions that you'll hear about from me, hear news from sister churches all over the world. American evangelicals are also going to church with immigrant Christians, either from Africa or Asia or Latin America, who come to the United States and either go to form churches that have already been formed or form their own churches, which are then a network with native-born American churches, so black and white. You'll also find a lot of expressions of this in non-church sites, that is, Christian news media, the literature of organizations, and popular culture. That is, the notion that this Christian community and the evangelical community in particular is truly a global one. Now, of course, most U.S. Catholics have been conscious of this for a long time, but among American white and black evangelicals in the U.S., the awareness, the intensity of the awareness is really different than it was before. At a conference recently that I went to, one white participant said something to me that probably would have been unimaginable from a white evangelical 10 or 15 years ago. I can't avoid thinking about global issues, he said. I'm part of a third world religious group. Within this, Christian young people are crucial. They raise money. They go on service missions to Latin America or Africa or Eastern Europe, and they are local activists, often talking and thinking about global issues. At the same time, they are self-consciously making evangelical Christianity into something more hip, culturally conscious, politically engaged, and globally aware. I'm going to show you here in just a second a music video by a group called Audio Adrenaline. Has anybody ever heard of them? Listen to them? They broke up last week. Don't ever do like contemporary stuff, you know, because then they still matter. They matter. Their music is still around. Audio Adrenaline is contemporary Christian music. For those of you who don't listen to it, that category involves a lot of different kinds of things, rap and traditional rock and even some country music. Contemporary Christian music is part of almost every evangelical service in the United States today of anything over the very smallest and most conservative churches. In some of the larger churches, you have full bands, drums, guitars, playing this rock-influenced Christian music in a variety of different services in many, many churches around the country. And listening to the music is a key site for younger Christians, evangelical or Catholic or otherwise, to form identity and community. The music is really often quite popular, and some of the bands are crossover bands, which I'll talk about. Now, watching this video, you'll see that Audio Adrenaline has been influenced by secular music. You know, however Christian they are, they were definitely watching some MTV, some earlier time in their life. And they also have a kind of a good bit of postmodern, ironic style in a way. There's also a little, more than a little bit, I would say, of a certain kind of paternalism about saving the third world here. still, for those people who still think that American, white American evangelical Christian culture means the 700 Club or even the Left Behind novels, this kind of thing it can be surprising. So, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't warn you that we were going to do that. Yes, we need DVD and we need some hope of actually getting it going. Let's see. All right, let's see. Can we get a light off? Is there? Where do we do that? Here? Right here? See what happens? I don't know what I did. All right, not too bad. All right, let's see. Ah! This is like you have to hit it really hard. There we go. Handing my that back. Thank you. And my lights, yes. Thank you. So I know the first time you hear these things, sometimes it's a little hard to follow, but at one point they say, touch the world the way you've touched my heart. And there are another different places where he says, I want to do for the world what you've done for me. Now, some people would argue
that there's fantasy here of the benevolent imperialist, that is, young children providing a kind of local color to a narrative for and about white people doing good. But I also think there's something striking well beyond that. That the music, I find it very moving, so I probably why I do this work, because you can really get me with that sort of thing. But I think the music isn't unusual. That's what's important about it. That it's not, that it's very typical in a way of a whole range of music and literature that's tied in all sorts of ways to the on-the-ground expressions of young evangelicals that they want to do something other than live their own selfish lives. The injunction to go, for example, which is repeated over and over and over again, you probably got that in the video, I think probably speaks not just generically to people to ask them to help, but particularly to those young Christians who've become increasingly involved in the short-term missions movement. The short-term missions movement emerged about 10 years or so ago, involving organizing people, mostly young people, though not necessarily, to go on missionary trips of 2 to 13 weeks to do certain kinds of specific things you can do in that period of time. So they often go, say, to Belize or, you know, Nigeria, and they work to build clinics or help dig wells. About somewhere between 350,000 to 600,000 people a year go on short-term missions. Some of the promoters say 1 to 4 million, but I don't believe that. The Billy Graham Center says 350,000, so probably that's right. But they go, you know, we're still talking about hundreds of thousands of people every year, and it's been going on for quite a few years. When they go, they often aren't able to proselytize because they don't have the language and they're just going for a short period of time. But sometimes they do because they can show, for example, the Jesus film, which is a 1978 film about the life of Jesus, which the campus was made by Warner Brothers, but the Campus Crusade for Christ collaborated in it, and they've now distributed it around the world. It's been dubbed into 870 languages. And they take it on little, you know, kind of DVDs or VHS and show it in very remote villages. They say it's been shown to 5 billion people all over the world. I don't know how to assess that claim, but a lot of people. Now, among evangelical short-term missions, we could talk about it, is a very highly contentious issue about whether it's effective, whether it's a good way to spend money. But there's no question that it's become part of the fabric of local church experience for a lot of people, especially young people. Even those who don't go hear a lot about it. So I think the video here is important precisely because it does speak to something much larger, and it's important in its ordinariness as part of this global consciousness that I'm arguing is part of the woof and weave of evangelical life today. A focus on the persecution of Christians globally is one of the most striking aspects of this new internationalism. And then, let's see if I have something. Yep. Well, that's audio journal on there, promo picture. It's become a key topic within the evangelical public sphere. A rich network of magazines, broadcast outlets, internet sites, recorded sermons and videos, and popular books, which you see here covers of quite a few of them, both fiction and nonfiction. Specifically, in evangelical life today, tales of Christian martyrdom are part of popular culture. In books like Paul Marshall's Their Blood Cries Out, or Grace Burnham's In the Presence of My Enemies, or Extreme Devotion down here, or The Light Force, an account of someone caught in the Middle Eastern, the church caught in the Middle Eastern crossfire. A whole range. I mean, I could have given you slide after slide of these. I Dared to Call Him Father, Muslim Woman Converts, Heavenly Faith, Christian Goes Through China. Tales of martyrdom are also in music, at conferences, and fundraising letters. The issue unites not only conservatives, but liberal and moderate evangelicals as well. It's chronicled in magazines ranging from the right-wing World magazine, which I mentioned at the beginning, to the moderately conservative Christianity Day, to the left-leaning Sojourners, and the liberal Protestant Christian Century. Now, let me be clear as I talk more about this, that religious freedom is genuinely under threat in many parts of the world. Religious groups in general, and Christians specifically, do face discrimination and violence, sometimes organized by governments such as China or Saudi Arabia, other times because of widespread social marginalization or even just local communal conflict. I just gave a version of this talk at the American University of Beirut, where Christians and Sunni and Shia Muslims went to civil war for 15 years. I was nervous. But that reality that Christians face persecution or difficulty or sometimes martyrdom or sometimes just social conflict is real. And that attending to those dangers for Christians and others must necessarily, in my view, be part of any foreign policy that takes human rights seriously. So it's not that religious persecution doesn't matter, since I believe it does matter a great deal. Instead, I'm talking today about the specific ways it has come to matter to American evangelicals, the ways it has come to be quite frequently an avenue for presenting Islam as a preeminent global danger. And though I won't talk about this in detail today, it's also become a way for American evangelicals to present themselves as under attack and each setback of their political agenda framed as another instance of persecution. Within looking at these global issues, a passionate concern with the persecuted body, that is, the body or Church of Christ and the literal bodies of believers, animates this new kind of activism. In this, the internet is key, as well as these books and things I'm talking about. Here you see the sites of just a few of the scores of sites that are on the web that highlight Christian persecution. And you see a range of them, the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church, persecution.com, Christian Freedom International. I'm not trying to make fun, but I just think it's just incredibly telling that you have both persecution.com and persecution.org, so it's really everywhere. One of the groups that is very active in this is a group called Voice of the Martyrs. And they also, by the way, they don't just have websites. They email people and ask for them to give prayer requests for those who are suffering. They raise money for direct support. They do political lobbying, which I'll talk about. Voice of the Martyrs is one of the groups that's involved in this. And they, like others, distribute a lot of videos and DVDs directly to churches or at conferences to highlight the kind of work they're doing. The video I'm going to show you now is a fundraising video. But it's you can go and... we'll hope it works here. A fundraising video, but it's also educational. That is, you can get it free from the Voice of the Martyrs website or pick it up at Christian events, and it's supposed to, will teach you about Christian persecution and is used to raise money for Voice of the Martyrs. It focuses a lot on Sudan, which has become a central issue for American evangelicals. And you'll also see that Islam is explicitly framed as a danger to Christians. It's a little bit hard to watch because it shows injured bodies quite specifically.
Imagine. Islamic soldiers force your 10-year-old son to gather wood for a fire. The soldiers pressure him to convert to Islam. When he refuses, he's thrown on the burning wood he collected and left to die.
They told me I would be released if I became a Muslim. I told them that was not possible. I am a Christian, so they threw me on the fire.
Your son escapes, but the scars remain, a reminder of his sacrifice. Imagine, your teenage daughter goes to Bible camp. On the second day, the students are attacked. One of the attackers secures her hands behind her back, while another holds a piece of broken glass to her stomach. She's told to deny Christ.
I did not answer him, so he pressed the glass harder against me. Do you believe your God can help you? He asked.
Gripped with fear, she cries out, "Help me, Lord, I do not want to deny you." Imagine, your pastor has refused to register his church with the government. During the service, he's dragged from the church and beaten by the local police. When the officers find a Bible hidden in his shirt, he's beaten with it.
After returning home, I felt pain all over my body. It was almost numb at the beginning, but later became so painful that I could not sleep.
It is the fifth time he's been arrested. If he's caught again, the police say they will kill him. Every day, thousands of Christians are persecuted for their faith. Hundreds are martyred, about one every 3 minutes. They're not heroes or statistics, they're family. In over 40 nations around the globe, our family is assaulted for their testimony of Jesus Christ. In most instances, the persecution could have been averted if they had simply denied Christ. But they didn't, and they won't. In Sudan, an Islamic army set on jihad, or holy war, has systematically targeted Christians. Death and suffering can be seen throughout the countryside. Countless Christians are being displaced within their own country. Fleeing from persecution, they've lost everything, often arriving at refugee camps with nothing more than the clothes on their backs. In spite of heavy persecution, the church in Sudan continues growing at astonishing rates. Many of the believers bear the scars of their faith, but they also bear a testimony to God's faithfulness. Over 500 churches have been destroyed in Indonesia. On the island of Ambon, Christians have been massacred in the so-called religious cleansing by radical Muslims. Facing increased persecution, pastors in Jakarta have encouraged their congregations to stand firm, confident that their suffering is a prelude to coming revival. With the fall of communism in Eastern Europe, many have hailed its defeat. But Christians in North Korea, Vietnam, Laos, or China would disagree. Hmong villagers have been imprisoned in Vietnam and Laos after converting to Christianity. Some have had boiling water poured down their throats for simply possessing a Bible in their own language. The Hmong tribe is the largest in Southeast Asia, numbering 10 million. Meeting secretly in homes, more than 2 million have recently committed their lives to Christ. The persecution facing our brothers and sisters is not a human tragedy. It's a spiritual reality facing the body of Christ. We may not be able to stop the attacks, but we can ease their pain. Through prayer, encouragement, and practical assistance, we can fellowship in their suffering. We can show them that they are not forgotten. It's hard to ignore their pain after you hear their cries.
Little dead battery we got going here. So there are a couple of things to notice about this. One is that there's the language of your family. These are your people, not separate people elsewhere. There's also the language on several occasions that, for example, the pastor in Indonesia urges his parishioners to stand firm, certain that this suffering or this persecution is the prelude to coming revival. And elsewhere they say, we may not be able to stop their suffering, we can fellowship with them. And that's really important for a group like Voice of the Martyrs, who are in some ways quite an extreme group. They, unlike some other groups who work on persecution issues, don't argue that persecution is destroying Christian communities. Instead, they argue, quoting the Church Father Tertullian, that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church, saying that persecution can be the beginning point of massive conversions. So they're often less interested in political action, say allowing eased immigration rules for victims of persecution, since they don't want to empty out these churches. They want them to stand firm as the inspiration for great global revival. And they then also, you know, put out videos like this, which are, as you saw, quite vivid and painful to watch, and that are often sort of seen as really, well, sometimes they're seen that they are accused of exaggerating some of the stories they tell, though obviously they have real people here talking about what they've been through. The thing about Voice of the Martyrs is that being extreme or you know, not being willing to engage in actually trying to relieve religious persecution directly doesn't make them exactly marginal or scorned in the evangelical community. For example, starting in the late 1990s, the very popular Christian rock group, this is just another example of web activism that I forgot to show you. This is the kind of thing you can get a daily prayer update. The popular Christian rock group, DC Talk, also no longer together, but joined up with Voice of the Martyrs to produce a series of books called The Real Jesus Freaks, a series of books for teenagers about martyrdom. And even the idea, the return of the notion of martyrdom among Protestants with this new salience of that idea of people who are suffering and martyred for Christ is quite striking. So that DC Talk, who and whose music remains popular and were very mainstream among Christian evangelical, in the Christian evangelical culture, matter. That is, since Christian music is such an important part of evangelical culture, of this emerging church, what Christian musicians do and say matters. It has an impact. And the fact that they took up issues of Christian persecution, like other groups that I'll mention, made Christian persecution and even groups like Voice of the Martyrs very much part of the new consciousness, global consciousness of American evangelicals and Christian evangelicals specifically. DC Talk also are symptomatic of the new multicultural face of what many people have called the emergent church. A lot of the Christian rock groups are, in fact, multiracial and multicultural, and DC Talk is just one of them. And they're actually Christian rock slash rap. I'm going to talk about how this movement has had direct political impact. But let me just mention briefly a few strands of what has enabled it to emerge at this moment. In other words, why is this happening? Why is this movement so strong now? And this emergence, I would argue, is linked very much to the globalization of Christianity more generally. So let me just mention three things. One is the increasing visibility and numbers of Christians in the global South, which I talked about, as well as the importance of immigration in the United States, means that American Christians, black and white, are becoming much more conscious of this global community. In relationship to that, are the changes in missions work the second factor? Now, I already mentioned short-term missions, but there's also been an important change in the way that traditional missions have been carried out. There are a whole range of changes, but I'll just focus on one. In the 1990s, evangelicals around the world launched a new set of initiatives to reach every people group by the year 2000. The 2000 and Beyond movement was international. It was founded by an Argentinian evangelist, Luis Bush, no relation, and it brought together a broad range of churches and denominations. Within that attempt to galvanize missions internationally, it was quite effective in raising the consciousness of the idea of doing missionary work and reaching every unreached people group by the millennium. Activists focused specifically on what they called the 10-40 window. That is the area between 10 degrees and 40 degrees latitude that encompasses the Middle East and South Asia. That is an area where, according to Luis Bush, Islam and Hinduism and Buddhism enslave the majority of their inhabitants. That's his term. So people begin to send more missionaries to those areas and then to talk about those areas of the world in terms of their persecution of Christians. And because Christian missionary work is limited in certain areas, for example, the Middle East, where proselytizing is illegal, in fact, the more you send missionaries, the more there becomes this conflict between those who want to engage in evangelism in a state or local communities that want to prohibit it. And third, of course, is the internet. Really, changes in communications technology more generally. Groups from around the world, missionaries or activists or local Christians, can use email and satellite phones to report back their experiences to communities elsewhere in the world in real time with images. A lot of the activism has this internet presence, which I mentioned, though I think it's important to say that it's not only an internet presence. That is, I don't think you can make a movement by just putting up a web page. And if any of you ever tried to make a movement by just putting up a web page, you'll know what I mean. It doesn't really work. You have to have a network of activities, a range of media sites, but also a group of people or groups of people who are willing to engage with those sites and that information. And that's why local churches have been so important in linking to these internet or other kind of media technologies. Okay, so now let me turn finally to the ways in which, and I say finally, but I have some information going here. It'll take a little while. The anti-persecution movement has had concrete impact on U.S. politics, and I'll mention three. First, one of the most important accomplishments of the persecuted Christians movement in the 1990s was its role in spearheading the 1998 International Religious Freedom Act. Now, that law required the State Department to issue annual reports on the state of religious freedom in countries around the world. It also formed the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, an independent group whose role is to keep an eye on the State Department, essentially, not to soft-pedal its reports. That is, there's a congressional and evangelical distrust of the State Department as too diplomatic, as being willing to kind of soft-pedal certain problems with countries that are U.S. allies. This is not unrealistic, actually. So this commission then reports on, they make their own reports about the state of religious freedom, and to push the State Department, because if their reports find a country to be of particular concern, that finding should trigger the president to consider a variety of responses, including sanctions, unless he gives the country a exemption, as he just did for Saudi Arabia. That's my point about the State Department. So, from the beginning, critics have charged that the movement to support the bill and then the commission that formed as a result of it were political tools for evangelicals and political conservatives who were mostly interested in highlighting Christian victims and Muslim persecutors. In fact, the 1988 Act can be seen as both a result of and an impetus for the anti-persecution movement, in that starting in the early 1990s, a very committed group of activists began to argue that Christians should pay more attention to these issues, and they used the movement to try to get the law passed to try to galvanize evangelical Christians to take up the issues, which they weren't necessarily doing. Those activists weren't necessarily all Christians. Michael Horowitz, now of the conservative think the Hudson Institute, is Jewish, but he's a conservative, and he believed that, he says that the moral situation of Christians in various parts of the world deeply concerned him, and he couldn't believe the silence of American churches, but he also sees it, and I think I'll make that clear, as an important issue for conservatives in general. Many members of the Commission on Religious Freedom are veterans of the anti-persecution movement. So Nina Shea, who's currently vice chair, is the author of one of the books I showed you earlier, In the Lion's Den, Persecuted Christians and What the Western Church Can Do About It, which was published in part to push for the 1998 Act. So I'm trying to show you here this kind of network of people who are involved in pushing a movement to get the law passed, but the push for the law passed isn't designed to help create a movement. So it goes back and forth in that way, and it's actually a good social movement strategy in some sense. Shea's book argues that there are two problems for Christians: persecution in Islamic countries and persecution in communist countries, the few that there are left. But clearly for her, Islam is the emergent, more serious threat, and she goes on about it at some length. Now Shea, the author of the book, also works on religious freedom issues at Freedom House, the conservative organization that was one of the primary impetuses behind this original act, and which now sees its job, and you have to get this straight, Freedom House, an independent conservative group, sees its job as pressuring the commission to then pressure state to take up issues of Christian persecution more forcefully. So it's, you know, a kind of outsider pushing on the outsider, pushing on the State Department. Except that Nina Shea, who works on religious freedom issues at Freedom House, is also vice chair of the commission. So it's connected. Now, Freedom House has made Islam one of its primary targets. It describes its religious freedom program by saying, quote, "The organization insists that U.S. foreign policy defend Christians and Jews, Muslim dissidents and minorities, and other religious minorities in countries such as Indonesia, Pakistan, Nigeria, Iran, and Sudan." I'm going to read that list again. Indonesia, Pakistan, Nigeria, Iran, and Sudan. Connect those dots and you get special points at the end. So I'll read on. "It's fighting the imposition of harsh Islamic law in the new Iraq and Afghanistan, and opposes blasphemy laws in Muslim countries that suppress more tolerant and pro-American Muslim thought." This tolerant and pro-American Muslim thought, obviously for Freedom House, tolerant equals pro-American, has no representation on Freedom House's site. That is, it's the quiet and meaningless caveat that's designed to protect a writer or group from being deemed as anti-Muslim, but in other contexts is virtually irrelevant to the kind of arguments that are being made. And in fact, Paul Marshall, who is a senior fellow at Freedom House and author of Their Blood Cries Out, one of the books I mentioned, when he writes, sort of dispenses with the kind of niceties that are the caveats I just mentioned. Writing in the Weekly Standard, for example, he's argued for getting serious about what he calls the war against Islamofascism. Islamofascism is a really kind of brilliant term because of its resonances with the Cold War, when communism and fascism were conflated under the term authoritarianism. So really trying to create the notion of Islamofascism as the new post-Cold War threat. Now, the commission does include a diverse, the Religious Freedom Commission does include a fairly diverse group these days, including the well-respected Muslim intellectual Khaled Abu Fadl. But it's dominated by Christian conservatives, many of whom are evangelical, and many of whom are central to this impressive network of overlapping organization, interest, and political perspectives that takes anti-persecution to be connected to the problematic nature of Islam. The underlying interest of the commission in the Muslim Middle East as a major source of threat to religious freedom is clear in several ways. That is, the focus on the Muslim Middle East not the exclusion, but more than any other part of the world. I'll just mention two things. On the website of the commission, there are a lot of publications. One of them is a transnational comparison of different constitutions in terms of religious freedom, but it only looks at Muslim constitutions. So there's only one major report on religious freedom, and it's a comparison of Muslim constitutions. And the only non-English materials produced by the commission are in Arabic. So let me mention a couple of other things. That's the first major success of the movement. The first project of the commission after it was founded in 1998 was to highlight the issue of religious freedom in the Sudan. Now, focus on the Sudan was a part of a larger groundswell of activism of evangelical Christians, both black and white. You saw it in the Voice of the Martyrs video I showed you, too. Those evangelicals pushed the United States to pressure Khartoum to end the war, the many decades-long civil war between Khartoum and the Southern rebels, which actually was key to bringing about the peace accords that were finalized early in 2005. Now, this is a very good thing. The peace accords between the North and South that ended this 20-year civil war, while certainly not a cure-all, have been a very important part of the possible process to ending something that has been devastating for Sudan for a very long time. And for many evangelicals, this is, in fact, the key victory of this international movement. And they're right. The problem was that many evangelical groups and some others engaged this very complicated political situation in the Sudan in a simplistic way. That is, their task, as they saw it, was to raise an awareness that Arab Muslims in the north were taking black Christians and others in the south as slaves. And that is distortion of what was really going on in the Sudan, which was bad, but wasn't exactly that. And I could go on about it, but I'll just mention a couple of things. That is, in order to make this argument that people in the north, Arab Muslims, were taking black Christians in the South as slaves, the groups had to, and often argued that the South was Christian, that most Sudanese in the South were Christian. And in fact, something like 20% of the Southern Sudanese are Christian. Most of them are traditional or animist religions. Even that, it's very hard to come by. The numbers of whether it's 20% are hard to come by because there are a lot of rapid conversions. A lot of people are being converted very quickly, but they're also often a nominal conversion, so people go back and forth between religious identification. They also argued in some of the publications and literature, you got some of this again in the Voice of the Martyrs video, that the goal of the North in the Civil War was to wipe out Christianity in a situation where oil, resources, communal identities, and power were every bit as much in play. That is, the North was, in fact, being very brutal. Northern government forces and their allies were being very brutal in the South. Why people were being brutal had as much to do with these other things as it did with any kind of religious conflict. Connected to that, some of the activists embraced implicitly and enthusiastically the idea that the Sudan was the latest stage for the global clash of civilizations, with Southern Sudan as the zone of conflict between what one activist has called jihad warriors and Christian believers. So Sudan becomes, for a certain number of people, this place where you can see the clash of civilizations at stake and playing out, and that only then furthers the notion that, in fact, that's how to describe what's going on in the world, a clash of civilizations, which I don't think is correct. But at the same time, and this is why this material is so interesting to me, really, some very interesting tensions emerged out of that activism in the Sudan. In the first place, they got a peace agreement. So, sometimes you say the the end there is very, very valuable. But also, as the activists, anti-persecution activists, were trying to get the U.S. government to put pressure on Khartoum, they decided to go after the international oil companies that were doing business in the Sudan. Like, okay, if you can't get the government, let's get the oil companies and see what they kind of pressure they can put on the government. So they tried to get the U.S. Congress to deny any oil companies doing business in the Sudan access to the U.S. stock exchange. Now that is, within the Republican Party, free market Republican conservatives are going up against conservative Christian activists who are trying to get the oil companies off the stock market, right? So, for example, Spencer Bacus, a Republican of Alabama, congressional rep, proposed an amendment that would shut down the oil companies, shut out the oil companies from the stock exchange. When you have to make a choice between dollars and lives, he said, you choose lives. So you have these Christian activists who are making an argument that goes very much against the economic interests of other parts of the Republican Party. Now, it should be said that this particular portion of the bill was defeated, but that's not my point. My point is that the movement was making these arguments and making them quite seriously. Finally, a third impact of the persecuted Christian movement can be traced to the strong links that emerged out of it to economic and social justice internationalism, which I talked a little bit about at the beginning. Franklin Graham got involved in HIV/AIDS activism because of his work in southern Sudan. He showed up as a missionary and as a warrior against militant Islam, and he emerged sobered by the ravages of AIDS. And he's not alone. In the fall of 2004, the National Association of Evangelicals, a moderately, well, fairly conservative umbrella group, launched the MICA Challenge, calling on evangelicals to support the UN Millennium Development Goals of having poverty by 2015. Now, those of you who are familiar with the history of white evangelicals at NEA is largely white, you'll know that for them to take a stance that actively supports the United Nations goals on anything is extraordinary. And the fact that they then took that commitment to the streets is even more interesting. That is, concerned about poverty, last summer at the G8 summit, evangelical leaders, including conservatives, showed up in Scotland praying outside of the G8 forum for them to do more for Africa. And as you might know, then the countries at the G8 forum agreed to double aid to Africa and to cancel $40 billion in debt. The evangelical activists were there pushing for that, those kinds of agreements. Now, I wouldn't argue that the focus on persecution is the only source of evangelical concern for global poverty, certainly. But the movement does have an extraordinary impact, in part because it's so visible. It's in popular culture. It's in books and documentary videos and in the Christian music industry. And as people learn about persecution, they often learn about the real situation of people, I mean, about their human rights situation, but about their economic and medical situation as well, and that has made an extraordinary difference. I'll end by telling you another story about a different group who have some connection to this issue. Looking for all the rock, the Christian rock fans, be happy. Jars of Clay is one of the very important Christian rock bands as well, almost as cool looking as Audio Adrenaline. In the late 1990s, they had a real kind of mainstream following. They crossed over with some hits. They got a couple of Grammy Awards. They were, in fact, part of this crossover tradition in Christian music that caused some concern among evangelicals about whether they were selling out or watering down the Christian message. Then in 2000, the band leader, David Hazeltine, read an article about Christian persecution in the Sudan. I had seen the pictures of torture victims, he said. I had read the reports of Christian women and children sold into slavery, but these people were not real to me. They were not yet brothers and sisters. That spring, having met up with some of the leaders of the anti-persecution members, he and several other members of the group went on a trip to Vietnam and China, where they met with underground Christian groups. The underground Christian groups in China are often very, well, there's a lot of controversy about the groups, and the group that they went with, they came back, and they started urging their fans to support the group that they had gone to China with, and that group is one of the groups that clandestinely distributes Bibles in China. That is, there's a limit on how many Bibles can be distributed. There are groups that clandestinely smuggle the Bibles in. And there's, again, that's a controversy even among evangelicals, but because there are some who argue that in doing this illegally, these outside activists put Chinese Christians at risk for greater persecution. But others say we're going to do this because it's the right thing to do. So in 2001, being concerned about this issue, they made a very savvy music video that was distributed with one of the popular persecuted Christians' books, which called on people to get more involved in persecution issues. So then as a result of their being interested in this and coming out with this in a music video, they went to Africa with another small nonprofit. And there, they came back very galvanized on the issue of HIV/AIDS, which they see as immediately connected to structural problems like lack of clean well water. So they recently formed their own charity called the Blood Water Mission, which you can see the really beautiful Christian symbolism there. But they also argue that what Christians in Africa, what people in Africa need is clean blood and clean water. So the project then supports well building and also raising AIDS awareness. If you go to the website of the Blood Water Mission, it asks this question: do you know your family? Today, your father died of a treatable illness. Your baby is deathly ill from unclean drinking water. Today, 6,500 members of your family will die from AIDS. Now, the interesting thing here is that opposed to the Voice of the Martyrs video, the term family doesn't seem to refer specifically to Christians. That is, the number of people who die from AIDS each day is a total of 6,500, not 6,500 Christians. Right? So do you know your family seems to refer to something more like the human family. Now, instead of focusing on persecuted Christians at their concerts, Jars of Clay asked their audience to contribute to their work for clean water projects. It's not possible for me to tell you exactly whether the members of Jars of Clay are liberal or conservative. They're avowedly evangelical. In that sense, they're likely and almost certainly theologically conservative. But they're also Christian rockers with a vision of social justice. They don't just raise money. They want to talk about Africa's poverty as a political issue. So they played at some of the concerts that supported the G8 summit. In fact, rather than struggling through trying to fit them into the definitions of Christian, of conservative or liberal, I think it makes more sense to say that the face of Christian conservatism is changing, and changing in some ways quite profoundly. However, in highlighting what seems to me to be a fairly dramatic transformation, I'm not saying that everything has changed. For many people, being evangelical today may not require much more in the way of global consciousness than it did in the 1970s, when China and communism were both on the agenda, but didn't require too much for most people in terms of daily life changes. Most evangelical Christians are not suddenly turning over their lives to fight HIV/AIDS, or even getting on their email to lobby for Saudi Arabia to be sanctioned for its lack of religious freedom. But some people are. Certainly, the Thousand Wells in Africa project doesn't begin to make a dent in the overall wealth of evangelical churches in the U.S. And also, though I think it's clear, I'm going to say it explicitly, I'm not saying that all of these transformations are good. That is, speaking from my own position as a secular liberal, I'm happy to see the work on African debt relief, but I'm deeply discouraged by the power of this anti-Islamic discourse to which many of these same evangelicals are major contributors. Ultimately, I fear that the notion of Islamofascism may have a more powerful hold on U.S. foreign policy than promoting the UN Millennial Development Goals, and I fear that. But I'm also pretty convinced that the two halves of this vision cannot be neatly separated. That is, observers like myself, can't really decide to parse out the liberal from the conservative and somehow support one over the other. For most evangelicals, their internationalism is of a piece. Protecting Christians, promoting what they believe is right, what they believe is their right to proselytize in all countries, learning and living their own multiculturalism, and taking a stance against global poverty and on AIDS. These are the pieces of the new Christian evangelical internationalism. Using all the resources of the evangelical public sphere to create for themselves a new sense of global community. There's not one global vision among evangelicals, but there's a clear movement towards envisioning evangelicalism globally. And that movement is transforming the meanings of evangelical identity, the role of American religion more generally, and ultimately, I believe, the terrain of global politics. Thanks.
So I'm taking questions for a few minutes. Yes?
I've enjoyed the talk. I think I'm confused about one thing, and that's the origins of this movement's ideology, at least in terms of the movement in an American context. Is it an extension of the kind of evangelism that was happening in, say, 19th century China, which would make it a sort of a nationalist project? Is it coming out of 9/11, which might make it kind of a religious reaction in the United States? Or is it out of a much more global project, which would mean it was fully international and had nothing to do with nationalism?
That's a really excellent question, and it's a little bit hard for me to be sure of what the answer is because there's such a mix of things in it. What I would argue is that it doesn't come out specifically out of 9/11, in that the focus on Islam, for example, as a terrain that needed to be proselytized and a place that enslaved people was very visible already by the mid-1990s. But for many people, I'm sure 9/11 was a galvanizing moment. The movement to evangelize, to focus on that for a minute, and I'll come to the persecution part, is very much a global movement. That is to say, most of the missionaries in the world today do not come from the United States or Europe to go elsewhere. There are a large number of missionaries going to Europe from all over the world, from Korea, from Nigeria, from all sorts of different locations. The U.S., I believe, is the country that sends out the most missionaries over any other individual country, but the number of missionaries coming from Africa to all sorts of other places in the world is rising rapidly. The two largest churches in Eastern Europe are pastored by Nigerian ministers and include Nigerian immigrants, but also East Europeans. I'm looking here because I have some statistics in one of my footnotes I can give you. And Louise Bush, of course, is the leader of this other evangelical movement I was talking about, the 2000 and beyond. I believe that South Korea sends almost as many missionaries to the United States as the U.S. sends to many other parts of the world. So South Korea still sends fewer than the U.S., but there are so many coming of those come to the United States. One of the an evangelical guy I know who's a white guy who works on mission stuff was laughing because he's involved in InterVarsity, which is a major evangelical student group. And he said that in the University of North Carolina, which has the largest InterVarsity chapter in the country, was dealing with the fact that the South Korean church had sent a whole group of missionaries to Chapel Hill. And it's like, they kept saying, we don't need missionaries here. We really don't. You haven't done your research. But there was this sense that the U.S. is such a desperately needed missions field that we get a lot of missionaries. So missionary work truly global, I would say. Anti-persecution seems to me to be also very much a global movement, but stronger in the United States politically than anywhere else I know of. That is, when I went to the World Evangelical Alliance meeting, which is connected to the National Association of Evangelicals, but generally global, there's people from Europe, people from Africa, people from the Caribbean representing their continent regions, and the evangelizing and missionary work there, persecution was a major topic. People were talking about it everywhere. But I don't know of anywhere else where it has the kind of institutional power that it has in the United States, that is to form policy. In that sense, it's much more nationalist. And I also would argue that we are seeing more and more people at the same time whose identity as American is connected to or intermeshes with an identity as Christian that isn't American Christian, that there's an identity as Christian or as evangelical, that you're an American and you're evangelical Christian, and evangelical Christian means something more global than that. So evangelical Christian is not a subset of American in that sense. So it's enormously complicated, and I haven't even gotten to the prophecy pro-Israel stuff, which I also write about, but I'm not talking about that.
This is a Catholic question for Brennan. When you were talking about of Christ and stuff. It all brought back my
evangelical movement, is it anxious to differentiate itself from that Catholic thing, or does it,
yeah,
just ignore it? Is it haunted by it? Is it competing with it? Is it?
Yeah. No, it's a good question.
That
and
one book, Extreme Devotion, I wonder who the punk from Extreme Unction.
I don't think so, but I think it's extreme sports. That's the pun. But I extreme sports, like extreme frisbee or extreme, yeah. Well, ask your students; they'll tell you about that. But it is Catholicism is a haunting issue here for a number of things. First, because actually the Catholics were there for it first, as you point out, and that these kinds of languages have been much more prevalent in the Catholic Church in many ways, certainly the martyrdom and other kinds of almost more liturgical language. At the same time, one of the interesting things that's happening, at least in terms of the persecuted Christian stuff, is that people aren't always differentiating between persecuted evangelicals and persecuted Catholics. So when they talk about persecuted Christians, I always assume that they're evangelical, and then you read between the lines, and actually, no, sometimes they're Catholics being persecuted. So in order to make the argument, because there are a lot of Catholics around the world, and they face persecution, if evangelicals do, they often do, then those situations are brought into the discourse without ever saying our Catholic brothers and sisters are part of it, but without ever differentiating either the Catholic Christians as somehow not counting, which when I grew up as an evangelical in North Carolina, I took a class with a guy who was a religious studies class at University of North Carolina. And the first or second day of class, we had Catholic students in there, of course, he announced that Catholics were much worse than atheists because they thought they had it, and they had it so wrong. So that's not happening in the persecution literature. And it's not, people aren't talking about it in that way. And often political alliances, at least in terms of trying to say, talk to the government of Laos about opening up certain kinds of church practices or allowing people to have services more openly in Saudi Arabia. A lot of the people in Saudi Arabia who are Christian are Filipino, and many of them are Catholic. So that those people are actually working together in those situations. Let me ask a person of the female persuasion. So there you go. Okay.
Yeah.
In Latin America, there's less common cause around persecution, since that's less of the issue in Latin America, and much more competition for conversions, absolutely. And so I'm not an expert in Latin American evangelicalism, so I can't quote you chapter and verse about what they're saying, but I know that when American evangelicals go to Latin America, the talk about like what's going to get you to heaven is fairly concrete, and it means those four things, right? A belief in the Bible, second birth, you know, being born again, those kinds of things. And implicitly and explicitly, one knows what that is not. That is not Catholicism. So there's much more kind of sense of competition around conversion in those places. And in other places where, for example, well, in Egypt, there's a lot of tension between evangelical Christians and Orthodox Coptics, who've been there for a long time, have been Christians since before the Muslims came and have their own communities. And evangelicals are competing with them both to convert Muslims, which is not that usually successful, and to convert Copts to evangelicalism. So you see it in a few places, but certainly not in America. Yes, in the back.
Yes. Hi, thank you for your talk. I want to get back to persecution, this whole issue of persecution. And I'm wondering what you think about this. I'm wondering if we can think of this notion of persecution as a counter-narrative to a much more hopeful message that we're used to, particularly the spread of evangelical Christianity around the world, primarily Lutheran apostles, second only to Catholics now. And so, you know, in my work, I'm constantly bombarded with a lot of literature that talks about the spread of Christianity around the world, people are being saved, and the world is becoming a better place. Yes, there's persecution, so forth and so this is kind of hopeful message about the spread of Christianity. But then you have this counter narrative about persecution. So I'm wondering, are those two things, are those two narratives in some way in response to each other, in some way, somehow? Because it seems to me, I don't doubt the persecution of Christians around the world, but I'm much more familiar hearing that with that more hopeful message about the spread of Christianity and how it's revolutionizing individuals, communities, and governments, and so forth, as the saying goes. I'm wondering what you think about that.
Can I just ask you briefly what your work is, that you're getting bombarded with Christian messages? Are you in religious studies? Or?
I teach at Harvard Divinity School, American religious history, particularly African American religious history.
Okay, so yeah, you would be getting the mails.
Yeah.
Right. I think they do, I don't think there's any question that they go together. That is, as there are more Christians around the world, A, there may be more persecution because there are more Christians to persecute, or they're more visible, or there are more issues of missionary work, you know, people coming in, you know. In Lebanon, there was a lot, when I gave this talk, people were very upset with me because they said, you know, these missionaries are coming, they don't have any cultural sensitivity, they're trying to convert people who are already Christian, you know, who are these people? You know, one of the guys says, I know religious freedom is fine, but don't you think these people should be curbed? I was like, well, that's, you know, not religious freedom. But, you know, so there was a real hostility because of the sense that the evangelicals have been coming in and being very visible and causing a lot of opposition. And therefore, and that opposition in this case was coming from Orthodox Christians. But as evangelicals are more present in more places, there's more response. And as Christians everywhere, you know, are making more and more conversions, there's going to be more visibility, more response. But I also have noticed, and it sounds like in your work it's different, that what used to be, if you read you know, mid-century, 20th century literature, when people talk about conversion, they talk about conversion. You know, somebody gets converted and now they're with Jesus and they may have struggles and they may become alcoholics and have to go back to Jesus again, but it's a conversion, right? You know, it's, you move forward. Here, conversion narrative seems so closely, especially in, from the global south, so closely tied to stories of martyrdom or persecution. So, so-and-so converted in Ethiopia from Islam, and now his family is threatening his life, and he's had to run off to this safe house with a group of missionaries. Or this woman stood up for her Christianity in India, and her husband, the guy who wanted to marry her, was a Muslim, and he wanted her to convert, and she refused, and he threw acid on her face. And she, you know, so that kind of, like, they're always suffering with their conversion.
Right.
To demonize the religious.
To demonize the religious other, in Islam, for instance. Because what's highlighted in that story, that Christian persecution, is the other in their encroachment upon this conversion of this community. So it has to go together. So you have this story of persecution, which at the core does demonize. I mean, and you pointed out Islam.
And I think you saw in the video that I showed the ways in which these people, I mean, of course it's about persecution, so it's going to do that, but these people are converting, Hmong people are converting, millions of them, and they will be tortured and suffering by these other people, and the story's much less on, you know, to use a Christian language, much less on their heart than on the reaction against them. So I do see it, that's my fear about the danger, that you want to say persecution is not okay, ever, in any situation, but that the discourse seems to me to fundamentally function as a way of both demonizing the other and creating a certain kind of sense of us as endangered that serves American Christians in a variety of ways. Yeah, American evangelicals in a variety of ways. So, Cynthia.
I want to ask you a question about, and the things that you showed us, it seemed to me, I first noticed it actually in the Voice of the Martyrs video, when the bodies that were on display in terms of people raising their shirt and things were all African bodies. And I thought actually we were going to see the woman who was talking about getting cut with a glass, but they didn't actually go there.
And the minister, actually, the Chinese minister, who's unbuttoning his shirt but
never
opens
does
it.
Exactly. And so it seemed to me that there was a kind of racial hierarchy, national hierarchy from the first, third, you know, middle world, and also state hierarchy that was encoded in much of the discourse that you were talking about. And the thing that actually sort of brought it together, what I wanted to ask you about was this morning I was listening to the radio and the BBC went to North Carolina. so when you said, had the South Koreans having the evangelicals come to North Carolina, I actually thought, that's interesting, that's quite fitting, because in a way, the thing that's sort of getting elided here is the way in which poverty, HIV, AIDS, and other things are racialized phenomena in the U.S., and they don't seem to be a target of these same evangelical groups. It's all about somewhere else, you know, leave my hands overseas to where, you know, other people need my help. So I find that a very kind of interesting conjunction, and I wonder about whether or not you've seen attention, whether it's through the Katrina hurricane relief efforts or, you know, just other ways in which this kind of message of social justice actually gets turned back onto the U.S.
Yes, in fact, Katrina is a great example. I would say that I'll say two things. Your point about the bodies is really interesting. In other situations, they do show, for example, if you look on the internet site, there is the woman's face after she was thrown, acid was thrown on her, but she's Indian. And I can't think offhand of examples of bodies of, like, say, Eastern Europeans or folks like that, but I would have to think about that more. It's certainly the case in something like this that it is about some notion of, the otherness or the third worldness of folks here is really part of their, you know, the sense that their bodies are suffering. Now, whether, in the question between their bodies are suffering because they're people who are, because people in the global South suffer, right, versus because we like to see those kinds of bodies versus others is a hard line to draw. The domestic thing, I think, is important because in general, I would say there's been a lot less work on domestic, you know, certainly on HIV/AIDS domestically, very little, because, you know, those problematic gay people keep showing up in U.S. HIV/AIDS issues, I would say, is one of the reasons. But Katrina, American Evangelical Christians were on it right away. And, in fact, one of the major groups that was supported by FEMA, now why it was supported by FEMA is another issue, but it was listed by FEMA as a primary group to give to, was an evangelical group called American Vision, I think, and it's not World Vision, it's a different one, who was there on the ground. Every major evangelical magazine that I read had covers on Katrina and people talking about what had happened there and talking about where you can give money to and what their organizations were doing and who was setting up with food and water and talking about race. So, Franklin Graham, well, this is again third world, but Franklin Graham wrote an essay in the Wall Street Journal saying that the reason American Christians have not been paying attention to the suffering of people in the Sudan is because they're black. If they paid attention to Muslims in Bosnia, see how complicated it gets? They paid attention to those white people, Muslims in Bosnia, but they don't pay attention to black Christians in Sudan. So he accused all the secular people of racism. So, you know, it's and the black and white Christians were working very closely together on Sudan. So I'm not saying that there isn't racism, because, of course, there is in all sorts of places, including evangelical communities and including, you know, structurally. But they were on the ground with that Katrina stuff. They are not on the ground on HIV. No, I saw a race as a sort, you know, issue around poverty, why people were poor and that they, you know, were having a hard time making it coming back and they didn't have resources. But I haven't seen it in terms of why did the state not respond. So that critique of the state I have not seen, except a little bit in Sojourners, the left. You know, Sojourners are to evangelicals what, you know, the Nation is to the rest of the country. I mean, you know, it's their, my mother would say, bless their hearts. You know, they're little, but they are right out there on certain issues.
One more question.
Okay.
Something that Cynthia said sort of got me thinking, and this is more of a comment than a question. I hope that's okay. You know, while I was listening to you and really enjoyed your talk, a part of me was more sort of troubled and about the liberal aspect of it, rather than the other parts that you were separating out. You know, and it seems to me that what's really going on here, and forgive me if I'm going to just kind of lay it on the table here, and my strong sense is that what's missing here is a kind of an analysis of power, how power is functioning here. And I wonder if, in some ways, we shouldn't separate out American evangelism from Christian evangelism in general, and make a more secure connection with, you know, with the way it's connected up with neoconservative politics, rather than say it's not an incidental thing. It seems to me that there is a In fact, there's an indissoluble connection between, you know, American evangelism and American neoconservative politics. But how to do with the way in which there's a shift, I think, today in the way in which power is functioning. It's no longer about, you know, ministering to the soul, as you had with Catholic missionaries during, you know, the classic colonial period. It's really much more biopolitical, isn't it? It's biopolitical. It's about ministering to the body. Right, and so the shift has occurred there, and that's how global dominance moves forward. So it seems to me that if you don't connect those dots, you know, that what one, if you're really actively going to think about this in terms of ethics or moral principles or the logic of it and how it actually functions, etc., its effectivity, in other words, how it's effective in the world, you know, not just do a kind of sociological analysis of it, you know, one would, I think, have to sort of think about the way in which power is functioning today, you know, and the way in which there's this connection. It's really not, you know, it's not incidental that, you know, that they're not just having an impact on foreign policy, they are foreign policy. You know, it's about understanding that, and I think, you know, and that's why it's very relevant what Cynthia was just saying about what's happening here. You know, why do we need the South Korean missionaries to come into the United States? It's primarily because, you know, it seems to me that this missionary activity is about American global dominance, you know, and it has to be separated from what the South Koreans are doing. Do you follow what I'm saying? It's more of a comment, and I'm just trying to sort of figure this out in the context of the way in which people are thinking nowadays about the biopolitical, you know, rather than, and not seeing these contradictory strands, as you were saying, you know, can we fight the liberal strand and, you know, and throw out the conservative, you know, aspect of it. No, it's actually the liberal side of it, you know, forgiving of the dead or working for HIV/AIDS, those kinds of things. That's where the real power is.
I see. I mean, I did say I don't think you can separate out those things because I do think they work together, not that we should separate them out. But I see what you're saying, and I think it's. I'm very sympathetic to that argument that it's the moment where people kind of take control of the what was a liberal discourse and reframe it in very crucial ways to augment, say, for example, the way that democracy has been promoted among neoconservatives as the thing that, you know, is the good thing that Americans are now going to be supporting, but which is in fact an implement of American expansion in the Middle East and elsewhere. So those kind of moves, I think, have a lot of similarity. I guess the difference is that actually
it's not really liberal. It's actually what it is, it's a shift to the biological. That's what's going on here.
Maybe what's going on here, but I mean, when I'm talking about neoconservatives being interested in democracy promotion, that's something that neoconservatives are interested in. I'm trying to draw a parallel between the way this kind of appropriation of a certain discourse and the appropriation of neoconservatives of the democracy promotion discourse in, you know, the political realm in Iraq. That move is a move I see what you're talking about, and I am very sympathetic to it. However, I guess I would say that I believe that the relationship between American evangelicals, conservative evangelicals, liberal evangelicals, and the state is a more complicated one than you're suggesting. So that, for example, when I talk to, you know, here in Boston, Gloria Hammond, who's head of the AME Zion, co-minister of one of the AME churches here in town, who went to Sudan with one of the groups that's like completely, excuse my, piggish on the Islam stuff, that's actually out to get Islam in part of its other work, but organized African American ministers to go to southern Sudan. She went there. She went three times with that same group, and she comes back and she's founding a group, you know, Sisters in Solidarity with Sudan, that's, you know, building wells there. She's a social conservative, a political liberal. She's deeply involved in social issues in the African American community in all sorts of ways. She's absolutely at the center of this kind of stuff. And she's not a neoconservative, and she doesn't fit that notion of how power is working. So I don't say she's, you know, I wouldn't say, as you did, you know, they aren't just influencing foreign policy, they are foreign policy. The networks are enormously more complicated.
It's not about individual intentions, it's about the way in which the system is functioning.
I understand that, but yeah. I think the system functions in very much more complicated ways than this unity of the attempt to influence. You know, that notion of biopower, I think, is very valuable, but the idea that it's a kind of systemic relationship that allows all that kind of positions all evangelical Christians equally in relationship to the neoconservative move to expand U.S. power. We might just disagree about how that works exactly.
Melanie, thank you so much.